Hi, I'm a historian, and today I want to talk about global warming. Now, that probably already seems like a bit of an odd fit. I mean, what do I, someone who studies the past, have to contribute to contemporary discourse on climate change? But it feels even weirder right now in the context of a pandemic. I have to admit, even as someone who cares deeply about environmental issues, that they seem a little distant at the moment, as we struggle to predict, mitigate, and prepare for the impact of COVID-19. But coronavirus and global warming actually have a lot in common. For one thing, they're both exacerbated by human activities, travel and social interaction in the case of COVID-19, and unsustainable energy use and consumerism in the case of climate change. They're also both getting worse. In fact, growth curves for these two crises look disturbingly similar. And finally, they're both happening right now, which makes it impossible, but also critical, for us to understand and address their future consequences. Now we're getting to my role as a historian. People in my field often like to avoid thinking about the present. After all, it's a lot easier to identify the consequences of historical events because they've already happened, and we have this wonderful thing called hindsight. But we also fully believe that history is relevant and that it informs our understanding of the present. We would echo the words of George Santayana, "Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it." So what can history tell us about global warming? Well, to answer that, I'm going to first explain what we know about past climate change and how we know it. And then I'm going to use a case study from my own research to show what that knowledge tells us about the human dimensions of climate change. So there are two key types of sources for climate history. The first is paleoclimatology, or natural archives. These kinds of sources give us data about summer temperature, winter temperature, and precipitation or rainfall in a given region. And they include things like ice cores, glacial cover, sedimentary content, corals, stalagmites, pollen, and tree rings. So as an example, let's look at dendroclimatology, or tree rings. So dendroclimatology, in a nutshell, looks at yearly tree growth and correlates that with climatic pressures such as temperature and rainfall. In other words, you can see how much a tree has grown and extrapolate information about the climate conditions of that given year, at least during the growing period. And yeah, you guessed it, that's me on the left at a dendroclimatology workshop I attended a few years ago on the campus of Princeton University. So dendroclimatology can be extremely valuable. For one thing, it provides one of the longest climate records for history. We can actually project it back beyond any living trees, which means we have approximately 2,000 years of high-resolution climate reconstructions from tree rings for different parts of the world. But there are also some key weaknesses and limitations to dendroclimatology and other forms of paleoclimatology. For one thing, they give us inconsistent and limited coverage. So you can only study dendroclimatology in places that have trees, and other natural archives have the same problem. In addition, some effects are localized. For example, rainfall in a certain forest doesn't necessarily imply similar rainfall in an adjacent forest. Finally, these kinds of data are most accurate on a really grand or geologic timescale. They're a lot less useful in trying to understand what happened in a specific given year. So for that kind of information, we have an additional source of climate history, the human record. The human record includes things like temperature records, particularly for the period 1850 to the present, which is known as the instrumental period. This is a period when people around the world began making systematic and relatively accurate measurements of things like temperature and precipitation. It also includes things like official reports and records, particularly for extreme weather like flooding, drought, and weather extremes. It also includes personal accounts and observations. And finally, paintings and photographs can provide an important supplement to the human record. Things like this painting by Peter Bruegel, which shows people playing on a frozen river. We know that when this painting was made, climate conditions were particularly cold. But just like natural archives, the human record has problems and limitations as well. Like natural archives, it's also inconsistent. It only exists for places of human habitation and only for places where people were actually talking about the climate. It's also highly subjective because all of these sources come from subjective human beings, and we tend to exaggerate. So now I want to talk a little bit about how we apply these different kinds of sources, and I want to use a specific example or case study from my own research, and that is the 1871 revolt in French colonial Algeria. So a little background. France conquered Algeria in 1830, and prior to that, it had been part of the Ottoman Empire. The indigenous Algerian population was comprised predominantly of Muslims who lived in rural habitations. So there were urban centers, but it was largely rural. And most of these inhabitants practiced pastoralism. They were nomads. They kept sheep and goats, etc. Or they were peasant farmers or both. Algeria was developed by France as a settler colony. That means indigenous Algerians were uprooted and systematically marginalized to make space for European and predominantly French settlers. In addition to the social, economic, and political challenges of the settler colony model, there are also environmental pressures facing indigenous Algerians in the 19th century, particularly in the 1860s. So 1865 was a particularly bad year. It included a rash of wildfires, a famine, and a cholera outbreak. But the years 1866 to 1870 were in some ways even worse. They included a series of environmental crises. Locusts swarmed across the region, destroying fields, pastures, and harvests in 1866. There were also various animal diseases or epizooties, leading woodstock to fall 25% across the country. And as a result, many shepherds had to sell their herds. In the summer of 1866, it brought major storms, including hailstorms and heavy rain that led to flooding. And the winter of 1866 to 1867 was unusually cold, and these conditions decimated those herds that still remained. 1869 was a little bit better. It was a mediocre harvest year, but this wasn't enough for people to recover from the challenges they had faced in the previous years. In addition to all of these things, the years 1865 to 1870 were unseasonably dry. So what we're looking at here is the PDSI, or Palmer Drought Severity Index. And this uses paleoclimate data to determine rainfall conditions over a given period in a given region. And on the map, you can see dates, different colors, and Algeria highlighted with a black circle. So regions that are red are drier than average for that year, regions that are green are average, and regions that are blue are wetter than average. So if we look at Algeria for the period 1865 to 1872, here's what we see. Years 1865 to 1868 were drought years. There were two normal years in 1871 and 1872, and only one wet year in 1869. So all of these challenges, both social challenges and environmental challenges, led to a significant decline in the indigenous population, up to 20% in some parts of the country. And they also led the indigenous population to rise up against the French colonial administration. The revolt occurred in the spring and summer of 1871, and it involved approximately 10% of Algeria's indigenous population. In the September of 1871, the rebellion was successfully crushed by the French administration. So what were the results? Well, the indigenous death toll was particularly high, approximately 25% of the total indigenous population, or about 500,000 people. In addition, indigenous groups were blamed for the revolt and charged for damages associated with it. And the period that succeeded the revolt, 1871 to 1900 is known as the settler colony era. It was an era of particularly repressive legislation against indigenous Algerians and increased marginalization. So what conclusions can we draw from all of this? And how have the climate and climate change affected human societies? Well, we know from this case study that environmental pressures often lead to significant social implications. They can contribute to things like instability, leading to revolts or revolutions. They can also promote economic shifts, such as urbanization or a shift from pastoralism to agriculture. They can cause demographic change, such as death and population decline. And perhaps most importantly, climate change does not affect populations equally. It tends to reaffirm and entrench networks of power. And those with the fewest resources are often among those hardest hit. That's actually true of COVID-19 as well. But there is a key difference between coronavirus and global warming. Eventually, this pandemic will end. We'll get through it. Meanwhile, anthropogenic climate change will continue to bring more extreme weather and raise average global temperatures. It will gradually, subtly render our planet inhospitable for human life. Unless we address global warming now, we as a species may not survive it. Although we don't have hindsight in this case, we do have history to guide us. And I think we can use all the help we can get.